So now we get to our panel on outrage activism. In this one, we'll explore how the digital revolution creates new kinds of personal psychology and new avenues of political power for people who feel strongly about things, sometimes for good, sometimes less so. We love social media when the Parkland, Florida students can mobilize a nationwide gun control movement seemingly overnight, or democracy movements can materialize in authoritarian countries below the radar of the government, at least at first. But we fear it when Russia trolls American democracy with fake news intended to polarize our country or elect the desired president. We distrust it when Facebook lets Cambridge Analytica or anyone else have our data for political purposes without our consent. And when a digital swarm threatens the Guggenheim and tries to intimidate it into changing something about an art exhibit for fear of people's safety as well as other forms of harassment, and the swarm participants feel they are the righteous ones because of the abuse of animals or whatever their issue may be, we are in a new era that we'll try to understand better now and try to figure out where the line is between right and wrong, also between advocating strongly for our rights and beliefs versus threatening the fabric of civil society. So here we go. For this panel, we have Danielle Citron, author of Hate Crimes in Cyberspace and professor of law at the University of Maryland Carey School of Law, Molly Crockett, Yale University assistant professor of psychology and neuroscience, and Melissa Ryan, consultant and digital campaigner, currently a visiting fellow at Media Matters for America, and editor of Ctrl Alt-Right Delete, a weekly newsletter in partnership with Hope Not Hate. And they've also determined their own speaking order. And we're gonna do the same thing as in panel one, 5-minute presentations, then we'll have a moderated conversation and we'll take questions from you. And we're gonna go Danielle, Molly, Melissa.
So I'm Molly Crockett. I'm a neuroscientist and a psychologist, and I started getting interested in moral outrage online after the election, as so many of us did, I think. I found myself spending more and more time on the hamster wheel of outrage on social media, as Angela so nicely put it. And psychologists think about moral outrage as a very ancient and powerful emotion that is experienced when we perceive some transgression or violation of a moral norm. And moral outrage evolved in a very particular context, in a context of small group face-to-face interactions. And new research is suggesting that the world we live in now, because it's very different from the world in which moral outrage evolved, that it's creating situations where moral outrage might be misfiring. So a useful analogy is to think about how our taste for fatty and sugary foods evolved in an environment where fatty, sugary foods were very scarce. And now, when we're surrounded by junk food and fast food, it's leading to an obesity crisis. Moral outrage is now omnipresent because we are constantly bombarded with triggers for moral outrage on social media. We can think about social media changing the nature of outrage in three ways: content, costs, and consequences. So in terms of the content, I've analyzed some data, and I found that if you look at how people experience outrage in their daily lives, they experience stronger moral outrage in response to content that they come across online compared to content that they come across offline in their daily interactions or on the TV or newspapers or radio. Now, why is this? I think it's because, as so many have pointed out, that social media platforms are driven by an attention economy where the more eyeball time content garners, the more money these platforms make. And so this creates an ecosystem that selects for the most outrageous content. And researchers at NYU have recently found that the more moral, emotional content is contained in, for example, tweets on social media, the more it's shared online. So moral emotions in particular are more likely to go viral. In terms of the costs of expressing outrage, again, in the context in which outrage evolved, it's very costly to punish somebody to their face. It's awkward. They might retaliate against you. Online, many of those costs are reduced. You can express outrage at the click of a button. You can hide in a crowd of thousands. So a contrast, before social media, if you wanted to, for example, protest an art exhibit at the Guggenheim, you had to make a sign, you had to go there, you maybe had to make some phone calls, write letters. Now you can just click a button on social media and join this growing chorus of viral outrage. In terms of the consequences of moral outrage, we can think about them falling into two categories, one being more personal and another being more social. Personal consequences of expressing outrage can actually be very good. It's a reputation booster. Research has shown that if you express moral outrage, people trust you more. If you think about the way that social media gets us likes and shares from everyone in our social network, these platforms dramatically amplify the personal rewards of expressing outrage. And in addition to that, the schedule at which we receive these rewards, which is a random schedule of delivery, research has shown can lead to the formation of habits. And so a worry is because habits are a sort of knee-jerk response to a stimulus that's expressed without regard to its consequences, that the design of social media platforms could be leading to more unintentional, mindless, and not thoughtfully considered expressions of outrage, which could have bad social consequences. In terms of social consequences now, and this is, I think, why we're all here, there's a worry that because social media, to some extent, segregates us into echo chambers where we're mostly connected with people who agree with us politically, that expressions of moral outrage are only really circulated amongst people who are ideologically similar, and they don't really lead to thoughtful, persuasive discussions between polarized audiences. And the NYU study that I mentioned before also found that on social media, moral outrage goes viral within politically homogenous groups. So what should we do about all of this is the question. And I think that there's sort of something that we can all do as individuals is just to be more thoughtful, more mindful about how we're using these technologies. I know that I've tried to change my own behavior in response to thinking more deeply about the psychological mechanisms that underlie the sort of stimulus response outcome sequence that social media platforms really pipe us into. But more broadly, I think we need to be having a conversation as a society about whether we're okay with our moral emotions being used to make money for giant tech companies, because that's what's happening, and it's driving us apart as a society.
Okay. Right. Okay, so I'm Danielle Citron. I'm a law professor, and I'm gonna take up, Molly, you left us thinking about the costs, the externalized costs, to ourselves as speakers of outrage. And I want us to think about the cost to the objects of that outrage. And more specifically, we see when outrage activism turns from general messaging that may be hateful and offensive, but we would say is clearly protected speech, to when that activism turns into something that's a crime, a tort, and in all sorts of ways violates the law. So what we've seen, and we saw it here at the Guggenheim, that campaigns can turn very quickly into cyber mobs that target individuals. They terrorize them with threats, with impersonations that suggest they're interested in sex and put up people's home addresses. They damage reputation with lies and spread those lies so that they ensure that they're first in a post of someone's name. And they invade privacy, right? And we can invade privacy in all sorts of ways, but often the cyber mob seizes on the home address, right? Doxes someone, posts their home address, and lots of their contact information, as well as their nude images, right? And often it's a perfect storm of all of those three things, privacy invasions, defamation, and threats. And so often the response, and I've been working on this issue since 2007, and the response, at least in the early years of my work on sort of cyber mobs and cyber stalking, the response was, Danielle, come on, it's the internet, it's ones and zeros, It's all protected speech. Get over yourself. Tell people to just turn their computers off. And the truth of the matter, and what I think I'm hoping we convey to people as they try to slow themselves down, and they start externalizing lots of costs onto the victims, right, with threats, with privacy invasions, with defamation, is that actually the First Amendment doesn't operate in absolutes. There are certain kinds of speech that cause so much harm and have so little value that they either enjoy no protection or less rigorous protection, right? So that includes true threats. It includes defamation of private individuals. And for public figures or public officials, you can sue for defamation if the lies are said with actual malice, right? Knowing that the facts are false or that you're reckless as to the truth or falsity of the matter. And you can't solicit a crime, right? There is a crime called solicitation. So crime facilitating speech can be prescribed, as can certain invasions of privacy, including the publication of private electronic communications, which is often true of the posting of nude photos or nude images online. And so the very notion that, oh, this is all protected speech, there's nothing we can do about it, you know, it's a myth. We need to bust that myth. And crucially, to understand cyberstalking as censorship, right, as silencing speech, right? So under assault, victims go offline. They shut down all of their profiles, their blogs, all the things that are crucial to make a living. They need to disappear. They're erased, right? And so once I think we start to understand cyberstalking as unprotected speech, it helps, I think, bring into view the victims who suffer the costs of that clicking, that retweeting of the nude photos without thinking about it, or the home address. And it's bad for, this kind of stalking is bad for free speech, right? There's very little one can say. There's no counter speech. I feel like this is what Suzanne was talking about, right? What's there to say, don't rape me, right? And the marketplace of ideas, you think only a very extreme version of it would say that threats and nude images are something we can debate, right? And it's true that harassers express themselves. They do use ones and zeros, right? And words and images. But I think we should be less solicitous of speech when it is designed to silence. And the one last thing, so I know I have like 38 seconds, but the last thing I'm gonna leave us with is that some of those costs that Molly talked about and underscored, platforms do not bear liability or responsibility for user-generated content thanks to a federal law called the Communications Decency Act. And so because platforms don't have to internalize the negative externalities that, of course, their users sort of put on others, we will often find that they're late to the game. We're seeing some good work now by Twitter and Facebook, but it's taken a while. So in many respects, we have to be part of the solution as well.
Hi, my name is Melissa Ryan. Thank you so much to the Guggenheim for having me. As Brian said in the introduction, my background is in online campaigning for progressive and advocacy groups, basically for the last 12 years. And a lot of what that is taking that moment when people want to do something and they express it online and convert that to meaningful action. So that could be online donations, that could be comments, that could be volunteering, that could be showing up at rallies. And a lot of good online activism is actually converting people to offline activism, so getting them to take the next step. Two watershed moments that I want to talk about. The first was in 2011. This was the year that you had the Arab Spring. It was the year that you had the Occupy movement that started in New York City and spread across the globe. I was actually engaged in Wisconsin that year. Newly elected Scott Walker governor had decided to take away collective bargaining rights from public employees and had the majorities to do so. Because I had been working in the state already, I was brought in to be the online person. And I noticed that the game had changed. We had just people who stayed at the Capitol in Madison for 2 weeks, and they communicated online. They largely organized online. And usually my work up to that point was finding the influential people, but every third person at that protest had their phone, and they were telling their own story on Facebook, and they were on Twitter. And I thought, oh, this was so great. Everyone has a voice. The internet has truly democratized activism. Of course, as we know, that's turned out not to be the case. In 2016, I had another watershed moment in that nothing the left seemed to be doing was working online, and I watched the right growing in influence and growing, frankly, in not things that I politically disagreed with, but tactics that were truly terrifying to me. It left to me at the end of 2016 quitting my job, and whereas I think many people stepped into the resistance for the first time, I actually took a step back, and I decided to learn as much about the so-called alt-right and the extreme movements as I could online. And what I found, interestingly enough, was I became a lot less interested in left and right and a lot more concerned about democratic versus anti-democratic forces. The anti-democratic forces, specifically being white supremacist, that they had made a determination that if democracy meant they could no longer have white supremacy, they were happy to give up democracy and they were happy to weaponize the internet to accomplish that goal. I don't think that activism is a bad thing. I don't think that online activism is a bad thing. I do think that the weaponization of the internet that has happened is terrible. So I want to talk a little bit just about the differences between activism and weaponization online. This is the framework that I work with. Weaponization is false amplification. So when you use bots or algorithms to make your movement seem louder than it is in order to silence others. The purposeful spreading of disinformation, whether it's fake news or conspiracy theories, so that people online are unable to tell truth from fiction. You see this after any kind of crisis or mass shooting. Misinformation will sprout up online immediately to the point where Twitter, whose whole platform was built for breaking news, it's very hard when events are breaking to be able to tell what's true and what's not, and that's intentional. Online harassment and doxing. If you are using online platforms to try to silence others and to try to drive them offline, and by the way, it is not a coincidence that most of the people targeted are women and people of color, because we go back to that anti-democratic white supremacist movement. And finally, the fourth one, which I think is a little less obvious but is just as important, fanning the flames because you can. So you're not necessarily looking for left or right, you're just trying to keep folks outraged all the time. We saw this with Kremlin IRA trolls. We also see this with people who set up hyper-partisan or fake news sites for profit. A lot of them will set up a lefty site and a righty site and just let them battle it out while they rake in the profit. So as we're talking about outrage activism today, I just want to make that distinction. No one's trying to shut down, or at least I'm not trying to shut down activism, but I think it's very important when we're thinking legally and when we're thinking societally about that distinction between activism and weaponization.
Fascinating. Melissa, could you mentioned the word doxing. What is that?
Actually, Danielle should probably take this because you've been...
It's the publication of someone's home address and other personally identifying information. So sometimes it can be really pernicious and include your social security number. But more often it's the home address, cell phone number, email, so that you are incredibly visible and reachable in ways that can, of course, turn into physical confrontation.
Melissa, I think a lot of people are experiencing what you just described, which is a kind of disillusionment, regarding the internet, which started from, we're really democratizing discourse, right, to, oh my God, what kind of a monster have we unleashed?
What the hell happened?
Is the positive outcome still possible?
I think it's possible, and I think a lot of the organizing that you have seen post-Trump gives me a lot of hope. There are two things that, Indivisible, for one, which started as a Google Doc, which, by the way, as a digital consultant, if you came to me and said, oh, I'm going to start a movement with a Google Doc, I would spend the next 30 minutes trying to convince you that that was a terrible idea. But this Google Doc that came in the right moment when people wanted to take action and didn't know what to do and has just blossomed into a whole organization. The other one are the Parkland student survivors who have grown up online. They are digital natives in the way that I have never seen. And they are so familiar with weaponization and how it works. And they have been able to turn that around and use the attacks against them to further amplify their own voices and their movement. So I think that even in what I consider the darkest time of the internet, there's still a lot of reason to be hopeful. And some of that hope, yes, you can find online.
Danielle, about the law, I heard a joke recently that goes, Why does God let evil exist on Earth? Because Earth is only a platform.
I thought he was going to say because we want to employ lawyers, but you know.
But do you think it matters what the platform owners, and we're talking about Facebook
lawyers.
And
by the way, I teach them, so I'm not saying anything. Yeah.
Mark Zuckerberg is going to testify before Congress this week, something he's been trying to avoid for a long time. And the question of how much responsibility does a platform owner have, that question is front and center now. As a matter of law, do you think the answer to that is changing or needs to change in a more formal way?
Right, so I think the answer to that absolutely should change. The notion that it's just a platform implies neutrality. But platforms are not neutral. They are constructed, they are designed thoughtfully. They are by no means neutral, right? They are trained on data that's infected with bias. Their designers, their algorithms are so designed by engineers, right? And then created. So there's nothing neutral about the whole idea that we're just a tech company, we're a neutral platform, don't blame us. That line's over, right? And so I think time is up for that Section 230 of the Decency Act, the immunity that was truly designed to incentivize self-regulation. It was called the Good Samaritan Protection for blocking or filtering of offensive content. It was by no means a libertarian enactment. Incredibly conservative Congress and senators created the immunity, but it's been so broadly interpreted to be a free pass. Even revenge pornographers have sites devoted to the posting of nude photos without consent, enjoy immunity from liability. It's gone too far. So we are seeing steps in Congress. There's a bill that addresses sex trafficking advertisers. It has been unanimously supported. It's not a fabulous law. I have a better solution. In my work, I've proposed a better solution. I think platforms now need to act reasonably. That seems so simple, right? But law has figured that out in negligence, right? And we can't pretend we are neutral and we have no part in it. We need to act reasonably in the face of illegality.
So I imagine an expert witness in a lot of those reasonableness civil suits will be Molly. Because you understand the psychology, the personal psychology of these social movements. Can you talk more about what you said before regarding the attention economy selects for moral outrage or outrage-inducing content?
Yes, and I would emphatically agree with what Danielle said in that these platforms are not neutral. Designers make design choices that influence our psychology. And so if you make a choice to set up a system where people are going to express outrage and then be randomly reinforced for it, you can't ignore the decades of psychological literature that says if you randomly reinforce in behavior, you can create a habit. And I don't think any of us want to think about our moral behavior being unintentional, but the research, I think, leads to a hypothesis that maybe that's what's happening on these platforms. And that's how you can explain, for example, in the wake of the Parkland shootings, liberals contributing to the spread of false news because they're tweeting about it because they're so outraged about it. And that is an unintended consequence. And there are many other examples where the very thing we want to prevent, the thing that we're outraged about, we add fuel to the fire because we're just sort of slaves to the design of these platforms where we automatically emit a response to a stimulus.
The tech companies, I'll say, have tried to outsource blame for this problem. You saw in the November 2016, Facebook's first thing is like, oh, we'll bring in PolitiFact and we'll bring in Snopes to do our fact-checking for us. YouTube recently announced that they're going to debunk conspiracy theory videos by posting links to Wikipedia pages, which they did not tell Wikipedia beforehand, which I appreciate. At a certain point, you have to take responsibility. You are accountable to your consumers, and I'm so glad to see Zuckerberg finally testify. I hope we see Jack Dorsey and other CEOs follow suit, because they need to be accountable to the public and to their consumers.
We can take questions earlier in this panel than we did in panel one. So if anybody has a question, I'll invite them in just a few minutes. So think about how you might want to contribute. I want to ask you all about the role of anonymity in this. You know, again, to reference the early days of the internet, I think there was that cliche, nobody knows if you're a dog on the internet, and it was seen as a good thing because people were sort of liberated to be themselves. And Molly, I'll stay with you on this, because I think of the social cost, the costliness, as you were talking about before, of being yourself and saying things that were risky. So there was something good that was at least perceived to be good as kind of, I'm a little freer to express myself than I would be in public otherwise. But now we see that anonymity can also be used to intimidate and to harass and things like that. So is this something you've thought about from a psychological standpoint?
Yeah, and I mean, I think there's a lot of research suggesting that people are willing to push the boundaries of social norms more when they're anonymous. This is not a new idea. One thing that I worry about, again, comes from the insight that many of my colleagues have supported with research, that expressing moral outrage gets you a reputation boost. And so this leads to a strong incentive to broadcast your moral character by expressing outrage that you may not even feel yourself. And so I think some of the other panelists mentioned a performative a type of outrage expression that would depend on actually having some identity to be bolstering. I don't think that requiring people to identify themselves will make this problem go away. If anything, it could be worse. The more people are identified, the more that they're able to attach to their reputation expressions of morality. And as we've seen from Melissa and Danielle, the line between righteous moral outrage and hate speech is not that bright of a line. There's a blurred line there, and so as people find others who agree with their particular ideology and get socially reinforced for expressing hateful sentiments, then it doesn't matter if you're anonymous or not, because once you've moralized it, then people feel good about expressing it.
Melissa, do you want to jump in on this?
I'm a lot less worried about anonymity, and I think politically there are, especially in emerging democracies, there are a lot of good reasons to foster anonymity online, so I don't think it's bad. It's the weaponization that really bothers me. I've had a lot of personal experience in online harassment since 2015, and it was a watershed moment for me when I realized that, oh, I wasn't being harassed by 10,000 dudes, I was being harassed probably by like two dudes who had like put a bot network against me. So again, like, it's not the anonymity that really freaks me out or worries me, it's that weaponization and that false amplification.
Can you talk more about how the bot networks work?
So you have to have a human person programming them, but it is such an effective intimidation tactic. It is great if you want to, you know, if you want to direct harassment at an individual, you can create a botnet with similar images, with similar messages that looks real. So it seems like several, you know, you're being attacked by hundreds of people. You can also use bot networks to amplify things in the press. Reporters cover Twitter all day. They're on Twitter all day. And there's this great trope in media, what's trending on social media? What are people on social media saying? And it became very easy with bot networks to game political coverage. And we now know, largely through Russian trolls, but some organic too, where people were able to game the system so much so that tweets from Russian troll bots ended up in legitimate news stories and shaped the coverage.
I think it might be helpful to think about bot networks as it's spam, right? So once our inboxes were full of Viagra ads, and we got spam enabled automated sending of email, and that's how a bot network works. Now it's not, you know, ads for something you don't want to buy, it's deep fake videos of celebrities having sex that they never had, or, you know, Russian, these kind of conversations that Melissa's precisely talking about. So And I think just to think about the real name, we have experimented with real name requirements, and there's very little upside and a huge downside. So the upside, one imagines that we'll slow down, we'll be more careful, and that's not true. We feel de-individuated behind a screen, we're gonna act out. And at the same time, what we lose, and this is to Melissa's point, we lose the activist in a country in which the surveillance will lead to death, right? We lead the domestic abuse victim to go offline. And so I think we, you know, have to think hard about anonymities, both costs and benefits.
Maybe that's the next subtopic that we should explore, is the physical threat from the kinds of online speech that we're talking about. Melissa, do you want to start on that, the extent of it that you see, this being a real threat to personal and public safety?
It's a real threat to public and personal safety. It's also a real threat to discourse. One of the things that really I found disheartening in the election year of 2016 was how many, and again, particularly women and people of color, activists and organizers that I have known for years, who just completely got shut out online. They became so apathetic, they became so demoralized, and therefore their voices were missing for the conversation, and it emboldened the other side, who saw how successful that they had come at shutting people down. And then you've seen some, you know, and again, Danielle can probably speak to this much better than I can, some really horrific examples of people's personal lives being turned upside down because of doxing, because of weaponization. I don't know until we solve this problem how we can have a civil discourse online or off as long as that threat exists.
So in my book, I interviewed 60 victims of harassment in a more sustained way and talked to so many others. And we see time after time that people's economic lives are totally destroyed. When a Google search of your name features your nude images, the suggestion you're interested in sex, threats, you're just not worth hiring. Not because you're not a terrific candidate, but as between two equally terrific candidates, you're gonna hire the person who doesn't come with the kind of reputational damage, because your client's gonna look at you funny, right? And we have seen instances of rape that result out of fake ads placed on Craigslist or Grindr, impersonations. When you're impersonated online in a sex ad that says, I'm available for anonymous sex, I have rape fantasies, people show up at your door. So there are documented cases and criminal cases that have followed the actual rape of individuals who have been, you know, sexually coerced, not only by the person placing the ad, of course, by the rapist who said, but I thought you wanted it. So we have seen physical stalking and rape.
Is there a psychological aspect to this?
There's a psychological aspect to everything, I think. One of the things that we're really interested in my lab, and this is a question that we don't have the answer to yet, but is a really important one to answer, is to what extent does online behavior spill over into offline systematically? So if you become engaged in an alt-right network and you start experimenting with pushing the boundaries on hate speech, does that make you as an individual more likely to take actions offline? And we have a lot of anecdotes about this. The Charlottesville marchers openly acknowledge that this had started online and they're taking it now offline. But we really need to understand the psychological mechanisms that predict sort of who, when, and how these sentiments can transfer from the web to the real world.
When you bring, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I was just gonna say that, Molly, that work, thank you for doing it. So incredibly important. When I was writing my book, we just didn't have enough empirical studies. I mean, we do about group behavior and all sorts of other kind of more social science, but we need that work. It's incredibly instructive.
We really do, and in order to do it most effectively, we need social media companies to share their data with researchers. And so all of you in the audience, if you find the opportunity to make it clear to social media companies that you support good research on how these technologies are affecting our lives, like, please add your voice to the chorus.
And of course you will respect privacy, because don't worry, I'll help you. Right? Companies turn over this data, and we will protect it.
And Molly, you mentioned the culture of hate in respect to this. I wasn't here for Sally Cohn last night, but I've read her where she has said that even something like the Parkland shooting, which was not a hate crime per se, can be seen as sort of a function of the digital culture of outrage. Does that make sense to you psychologically?
Absolutely. I mean, I think because, again, expressing outrage about anything is so heavily socially reinforced by whoever's in our tribe, that incentivized people to make any issue into a moral issue and express outrage about it, because that's going to win them likes and retweets and more friends and so on. So these incentive processes I see as running amok because of the nature of the technology.
And you said even that the way that social media is going and all the ways that you've said even changes our brain chemistry?
Oh, I don't know about that. I would have no way to verify that.
Okay. I thought I heard you say that in a previous...
But we do know that if you change people's brain chemistry, this can make them more or less likely to express outrage. So that's some work that I've done a few years ago now. But when people have lower serotonin levels, this lowers the threshold for moralistic punishment. And we know that serotonin levels are affected by things like stress, and poor diet and so on. So this is very speculative, but it's possible that chronic stress within a society could sort of lower the threshold for outrage. But I mean, there's no data to support that.
Melissa, where's the line, if you think it's clear, between passionately expressing your beliefs online and what you called weaponization?
I mean, for me, it's can you express your belief and can you disagree with someone else without shutting them down? And I don't mean necessarily an economic thing like a writer you disagree with or a television host that you'd agree with, but can you do it without doing it inappropriately? Can you do it without those four factors that I mentioned? Can you do it without harassing them personally? Can you do it without falsely amplifying your view? Can you do it without spreading fake information about them? And can you do it without inflaming to inflame?
Has anybody thought about the Guggenheim instance in the context of what we've been talking about today? Danielle, have you?
You know, in so many ways, it was like a prior restraint. They hadn't even shown the artwork, right? And yet there were attacks on individuals working at the museum with death and rape threats, mm-hmm. with the publication of home addresses, with direct emails and text messages that were incredibly terrorizing. Mm-hmm. And that served as much like you had to once get a license to print something before we had a First Amendment, right? And why we have the First Amendment in many respects is to allow us to freely engage. The museum couldn't. They felt like we would, I don't want to speak for them, but the concern, I think, was we don't want to endanger the folks who work at the museum if this art is, if we go through with this exhibit, we're going to see not only a rain of threats, we might see worse, right? And so I think that is a perfect illustration, unfortunately, of the virality of threats, mm-hmm. ways in which the cyber mob gains real steam, right? The more you see other people doing it, you think, well, that seems normal. I can do it too. And then there's this doubling down that might seem like two people, but it might actually be five people, but they create the what we call illusion of large numbers. Mm-hmm. And so that too is incredibly intimidating.
I think about the gold toilet incident, and when I read about it in the press the first time, I was like, oh, that poor woman. Because it's so predictable, right? Like, you know exactly, you don't have to study this all day to know that she is going to catch just a load of hell online, that it's going to be personal, that it's going to be comments about her appearance, about her age, about anything that they can grab onto. And I worry about the aftermath, but I also worry about how many people see that, and it's just not worth bothering at all. That they're intimidated beforehand. So it's like another level. You're not just intimidating your target, but everyone who is watching this and realizes that they too could be a potential target the minute they speak out. So I worry about the secondary effects that we don't even really talk about the way that we do when people are targeted.
I think that one thing I worry about, a broader issue that that intersects with the incidents here at the Guggenheim, is that if social media is lowering the threshold for expressing outrage and making it less costly for participants, then this means that not just people who really, really think this is a really, really important issue and want to protest it, it diffuses down to people who are just sort of maybe not as engaged, not considering the broader discussion, the broader context, and just sort of randomly participating and not thinking about the larger, broader consequences. And if that's happening for all kinds of issues, then there's a signal-to-noise issue. Because if everything is worthy of outrage, then effectively nothing is. And that limits the ability of outrage to actually achieve social progress.
Who has a question?
So practically, just in line exactly with what you're talking about in relation to the Guggenheim, practically speaking, what are strategies for an institution to push back against an online swarm? And once that swarm has receded, how do you pick out legitimate activist leaders to constructively engage in a dialogue from the wider swarm?
So yeah, what I advise organizations and campaigns to do, because everyone is in danger of it, is to really think about what's likely to happen before. And not just before a specific incident, but think about if my institution was hit with X, how would I react? Who are the reporters that I could talk to or have good relationships to help get our story out in the media? Who are my validators who can go online and offline and speak on my behalf? And really just because like once you're hit with something, there's such a limited window in which you can respond. And really by the time it's on Facebook, it's too late. I joke when I do trainings all the time, like by the time it hits my right-wing uncle's Facebook page, it's too late. There's nothing you can do about it, but that's true. So I think it's important for any institution, whether it's advocacy, whether it's a museum, to really think about, this is the world we live in, what is our crisis strategy gonna be when this happens? The other thing that I will say is if you're an institution like the Guggenheim, who I assume buys a significant amount of online ads, part of your plan needs to be, who is the point person who is going to talk to Google, who is going to talk to Facebook, who is going to talk to Twitter about getting some of this content taken down or the flow of information stopped? Because I find that the person who often goes to the tech companies is not the person who controls the ad budget, and they have the most power. So part of your crisis plan has to really think about who is the right person to engage the tech company and be heard.
So in the last couple of weeks, there was a research article published in the journal Science from MIT. You know about that. And it kind of reinforces what you said, but they went further, I think. They analyzed millions of transmissions of what they called false and true information, and they found that false information spreads much more quickly, much further than true information, and that the effect of bots was only about 10 to 15%, and it amplified both equally. And so they concluded, one of the conclusions was that it's the people who are guilty, or that's not their words, who were responsible for this fact or phenomenon. And that seems to dovetail into other studies that have shown that that the truth, showing people Politico, other fact-checking organizations, doesn't affect what they believe. The people always probably believe, lies or things such as they discovered, but, with the internet and social media, it spreads much faster.
It sort of doesn't matter what we do?
It doesn't matter what we do, exactly.
Does it?
I actually disagree with that. I think one important thing to realize about the reason that false news spreads so quickly is because the people who are putting it into the online ecosystem design it to be sticky and spread as much as possible. So it's not just that people are more likely to share false news stories, but false news stories and false news content is designed to be as clicky and shareable as possible. And that was my big flag with the MIT study. You're absolutely right. Look, when people are faced with something that contradicts their belief, studies have shown that the first thing they do is they don't believe it, they're in denial. And then I'll often just reframe their, if they decide to accept the fact, they'll just reframe their belief so that the fact doesn't matter.
Yeah.
I think one of the big problems that we get is it's not that truth doesn't matter, but we don't talk enough about these things in terms of values and in terms of societal norms. And I think that's another part of why the fake news continues to be sticky, because, you know, again, fact checks aren't debunking it, and we're not seeing a lot of conversation that goes beyond that.
Yeah, well, they say the thing, one of the things that makes it sticky is that the more outrageous or, you know, sensational, you know, the false news is, the better it spreads.
Molly?
Yeah, so the MIT researchers did do some analysis of the emotional content of what they called false versus true content. They didn't apply a specific analysis of moral emotions, and that's something that some research that I'm planning in my lab with a colleague who did the NYU study and is coming to work with me, we are going to specifically look at the moral content, moral and emotional content of any kind of information. I think that the problem is really upstream from the false versus true dichotomy. I think that focusing on fake news versus true content is a little bit of a red herring, and that a lot of the really harmful content that's spread online isn't fake per se. It's partisan, it's biased, but there's a kernel of truth in there. And I think the insight of the MIT study is that there are some emotional elements that are predictive of the spread of fake news, but I don't think that's specific to fake news. I think that's a general property of the spread of information online.
Molly, I don't know if, when you mentioned the NYU work, I don't know if you're referring specifically to Jonathan Haidt, but obviously his, also at NYU, and his moral foundations theories laid a lot of the kind of groundwork, I think, for such things. And what's interesting about him for me is that his kind of, he presents a kind of moral matrix for people on different ends of a political spectrum. But I think you can also do a kind of epistemological reading or a truth reading from what he's saying, in that I would say liberals have a tendency to attribute agency to systems or abstract things, whereas conservatives might want to blame people or kind of more literal, concrete things. And I feel like where you see the flashpoint of that, where both liberals and conservatives kind of fall into kind of camps that cannot talk to each other, is something that was mentioned earlier, which is conspiracy theory. So Parkland shooting, you have people on one side of the spectrum who are looking at the kind of atrocities of the US government, which are a matter of public record, going back 40, 50 years, whatever, that are saying maybe something else is going on here. Whereas you have other people on the other side of the fence that are going, oh my God, these kids are survivors, how can you treat them like they're crisis actors? And so you have this kind of orthogonality of worldviews that goes even beyond morals. So I'm wondering what is the, you know, is there a way to kind of bring together some of the insights that are coming from the panel around moral outrage into moments where you have totally disjointed systems of understanding the world, or truth, or epistemology, where people on both sides are actually really well informed, they're just coming from totally different axioms?
Mm-hmm. That's a great question. The NYU work that I was mentioning earlier was led by Billy Brady, working with Javen Bavel, John Jost, and others. But Jonathan Haidt's work is, of course, relevant, and he's been studying how liberals and conservatives think about moral events along different kinds of content. And for example, liberals care a lot about harm and fairness, and conservatives care a lot about those two things, but also respect for authority, loyalty, purity, and so on. I think the work that I've seen recently that's most relevant for making progress on polarization comes from Rob Willer at Stanford, and he's been running studies suggesting that if you communicate a particular issue using the language of the values that the other side cares about, you can be more persuasive. So, for example, you can persuade liberals to support the military more if you point out that the military is one route through which economically disadvantaged people are able to make progress in their life. And so really communicating the fairness aspect of how the military can sort of provide that that economic avenue. And the same holds for communicating the importance of healthcare amongst conservatives for really talking about sort of the purity of our health and trying to stop diseases and that would blight our communities and so on. So there is a way to communicate with the other side if you use the languages of the values that they care about.
Melissa, this seems up your alley too.
Yeah, so I will say that one of the things that I've seen with the marriage equality issue, I saw a great study a few years ago, and when you talk to conservatives about marriage equality as a fairness issue, they were more likely to be against it, and it would actually keep them moving to the right. But if you talk to them about, these are patriotic Americans, many of them serve in the military, and you know, frame them as like, they just, it's not equality, but these are patriotic Americans contributing to society, and they deserve to be with the person you love, you were able to move them better. And I think that is, you know, when you're thinking about changing minds, you know, there is that persuasion element that has definitely gotten lost.
Well, I think our two panels today have been really different and incredibly interesting ways. You three were amazing and so information rich, and I am just so, you know, honored to have just been able to be up here and facilitate a little bit. And so you three have been great, and please thank our wonderful panel. And thank you all for coming today.
I just want to thank everyone for spending the afternoon with us. This was incredibly elucidating. I think I can speak on behalf of my Guggenheim colleagues. We're just so lucky to have all of you, and Brian, for you, your excellent moderating. We feel like we've been heard and that we've learned from all of the subjects you've addressed, and hopefully we will internalize all of this and figure out our next steps for both exhibition programming and public programming, because clearly it's a conversation that needs to continue. So thank you all.